Be sure to watch Sitare every week to catch your favorite star profiles, celebrity interviews, community events, and more.
Sitare TV.
Sitare TV.
Sitare TV.
Sitare
right
TV.
Here.
Sitare TV.
Sitare TV.
Sitare TV.
Sitare TV.
Whenever it's community and whenever it's direct effect to the community, Sitare TV always is there. It's proud to cover Vibrant Gujarat Committee, a visiting Bay Area organized by some awesome USISPF group, and we had opportunity to talk to them. Sitare TV has covered this event, and let's walk you through the glimpses and of course interviews with the renowned delegates from India.
Today, to tell you a little bit more about that and to introduce our guests for today is my COO from USISPF, Gaurav Varma. Gaurav has been part of this organization. This organization is just 1 year old now, but he's been part of this continuing strategy for that, and its predecessor since 10 plus years. So he has a lot of experience. So help me in welcoming Gaurav Varma, COO of USISPF.
Dipti, thank you very much. It's hard to believe that there's someone in the crowd who doesn't know you. Friends, thank you for joining us. It's Sunday evening, so we absolutely appreciate your coming out to be with us. Gujarat is an important state, and they mean business. The delegation's already started their trip today. They've already signed one MOU with PSA in Concord today. Rashid, the PSA Vice President and Chief Pilot, is already here with Jay. So we've already started working on trying to bring investments into Gujarat, collaborations into Gujarat. This is possibly the only state out of India where you will see that a senior functionary of the administrative service, and in this case it's Mr. Arvind Agrawal, who's the additional Chief Secretary, a senior person travels with just one member of the government. Everybody else around him is from the industry. So they appreciate what the industry brings to the table, and they believe in the fact that to attract more, you have to go with your best foot forward, and in this case, it's the industry from Gujarat. So we'd like to begin the program. I'd like to request Ambassador Ashok Venkatesh, the Consul General here in San Francisco, to say the opening remarks, and then we'll kick off with the program. Thank you.
It's my pleasure to welcome Shri Arvind Agarwal and the delegation from Gujarat, which, as you just heard, is top heavy with business people. This is a state, for those who are not from Gujarat, which does not actually need introduction because it is one of the most dynamic states in this country and in India, and it is also been a path leader in terms of technology, in terms of showing the way on how to develop. And today the focus, as I was told, is on Gujarat moving much more towards manufacturing and services. We are a large country, and when Gujarat talks about manufacturing and services, it's not just for Gujarat, but it's for the whole of India. And as you will hear from the additional Chief Secretary later in the day, this is part of the remit of this delegation here. It is a fact that the amount of money a company can make is much more in the developing world than in the developed world, because the not only the fact that the middle class itself is increasing globally from about 3.3 billion today to about 5.6 billion in another 10 years or 12 years, but also because the incremental amount of value, potential net value in terms of the addition increase in investment which will go into the countries which are termed as emerging countries is far more than what will go into markets in the West, in the OECD, which are already relatively saturated. And this is why, if you see that there is a desire for companies in the US, in the OECD, to move towards countries like India. And we remain, in spite of all the issues which are there in terms of the falling rupee, we remain the fastest growing large economy in the world. Gujarat will offer great potential, great possibilities. And I also direct you to the fact that 68% of India lives in the rural areas, and the technologies that are developed in the Silicon Valley in terms of innovation in IT, in terms of innovation in industry, have equal application in the rural area as they do in the urban areas. And in all the verticals, whether you take it as agriculture, industry, entrepreneurship, power, water, sanitation, healthcare, in all these areas, now IT and innovative ideas from here are coming in. You are aware that blockchain technology is coming in a big way. Some states in India, like Andhra, Telangana, and Maharashtra, have already adopted some components of blockchain. I understand that Gujarat may also be doing so. Government of India has adopted the India chain. And with these technologies coming in, you will see all the aspects, whether it's healthcare or it is industry or it is any other thing, also being put onto blockchain. And the other happy news is that Gujarat is home to iCreate and the innovation which takes place there. And it is a great possibility for countries like US, Israel, and India to join hands with organizations like iCreate to create new technologies which can change not only our India, but also the rest of the world. I welcome the Gujarat delegation, and we look forward to their presentation.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Arvind Agarwal. I am the Additional Chief Secretary, Finance Department, Government of Gujarat, leading the Gujarat delegation to the United States. One of the objectives is, of course, to promote the Vibrant Gujarat Global Summit, which Gujarat government organizes once in 2 years in January. And this time it is organizing it on 18, 19, 20th January, about which I'll tell you more as we go along. But the main purpose is to promote bilateral trade and commerce between Gujarat and US. There was a time when this was an investment summit to bring more and more investment into India or to try for that. Gujarat is today a well-developed manufacturing state, and the purpose of the summit this time, as I was just discussing with the ambassador, is to promote trade and commerce not only for Gujarat but for India as a whole, to move away from manufacturing. Of course, our core will always be manufacturing, but to move away and go more into services, whether it is education, whether it is healthcare, it is financial services of GIFT City. You must have all heard of the only international financial services center in India, and so on and so forth. I will take you through the presentation, 15 minutes. I will try not to exceed my brief. About India being amongst the world's fastest growing economies, we are 2.8 trillion, third largest economy by PPP after US and China, which you would be aware of, sixth largest economy by nominal GDP. GDP of 8.2% in the last quarter, but generally it has been 7.5% over the last year or so. Last year, third largest startup investor base after USA, UK, it is India. Only country amongst BRICS and South Asian economies to feature prominently in the ease of doing business index. This growth in India is expected to stay. Actually, once you reach a takeoff stage, it is felt that yes, the going is good, and with the existing policies, definitely there will always be potential for much more. And there is a lot of criticism that India is not achieving its full potential. Having said that, there is a feeling amongst all segments of economists and policymakers, the India growth story is there to stay. It may vary between 7.5%, 8%, or as people say, it should reach 10%. So structural reforms will take the GDP beyond 8%. 10th preferred investment destination in the world last year. US is the 6th largest investor in India of $23 billion. This we are counting since 1991 when India opened up its economy. But what is important is the cumulative FDI, from 2000 when we started actually counting it, it is $563 billion. And last year the inflow of FDI was $45 billion. Something about Gujarat, we have 6% of the geographical area, but only 5% of the country's population. But what is important is that we account for 8% of India's GDP. We account for 40% of India's cargo. Of course, we are a coastal state, but there are many other coastal states. We have made some important maritime policies for which we account for 45%, and now the whole focus is on developing private ports. 22% of India's exports are from Gujarat. Of course, gems and jewelry and diamonds also has a major role to play in that. But petroleum products, we are the largest oil refiner in India. And export of oil after refined petroleum is very important. So 17% of India's total industrial output is accounted for by Gujarat. 17% of total net value addition in manufacture just after Maharashtra. 10% of India's total number of factories, and with Gujarat has 10% of total number of factories, but they account for 17% of industrial output, which shows the greater efficiency in the Gujarat industry.
Iski technology vaqai raah dikhane layak hai. With its standard pedestrian detection system and pre-collision system. Lekin iski cutting edge styling hai vaqai dekhne layak. Ek baar experience karke dekhiye. The Lexus NX and the NX Hybrid, class leading 31 mpg combined estimate ke saath. Lease kijiye 2019 Lexus NX 300 for $339 a month for 36 months. Experience amazing at your Lexus dealer.
For an insightful view of the world, there is no paper like India Post. For more than 15 years, India Post readers have expected their newspaper to provide the most thorough and uncompromising coverage in the world. Community Across America is a unique section of India Post that covers social, political, and cultural events involving the Indian American community. We also feature health science, lifestyle, and travel and hospitality. Free distribution through grocery stores, temples, gurdwara, corporate offices, restaurants, and more. Check us out at indiapost.com.
It's a Gujarat has always prided itself by being a manufacturing powerhouse, and we are the national leader in refining, petroleum refining more than 50%, chemical and petrochemicals more than 50% of the country's output, dairy, you're all well aware of Amul and others, drugs and pharma more than 40% of India's output. Cement, more and more cement companies are now coming into Gujarat. It's become a national leader in cement production, textiles, engineering, gems and jewelry, everyone is well aware of, and ceramics, everyone is well aware of. 36% share of manufacturing, the average India's share is about 26% of India GDP is manufacturing. Gujarat has 36%, and we are much lower percentage of agriculture in the GDP, which is a symbol of growth of the national economy, the state's economy. Our contribution to various key products in the country is very high, but let me just touch upon plastic, 65%, petrochemicals, crude oil, chemicals, glass, and textiles, almost 20%. This is the growth in FDI in Gujarat. So it has grown at 58% between 13-14 and 16-17. Probably it has grown so high because we initially started with a fairly low base. But over the years, we are attracting very substantial FDI. From just 807 million in 2009-10 to over almost 3.5 billion in 2016-17. These are the sectors in which Gujarat is attracting FDI, led by automobiles, telecommunications, cement, power, chemicals, and others. It is India's top performing state. It's the leader in the industrial intentions that are filed amongst all the states. It is leader in logistic ease. There is an index, logistics ease across different states index, published by Government of India. It is the leader, the only state in the country to have a functional PCPIR. This policy was announced almost 12 years ago. And petroleum, chemical and petrochemical investment region in Dahej in Bharuch district in South Gujarat spread over 450 square kilometers. And first and only state in India to have a fully functional gas grid and water grid. In fact, gas is one of the clean fuel, one of the USPs of Gujarat, where the piped gas supply in the city area is maximum. And one word I would like to say about gas: total share of natural gas in European economies is on an average 33%, 33-34% of the total energy consumption. In Gujarat, it is 33-34%. So in terms of gas, the share of gas in total energy consumption, the various fuels that are used for energy generation, gas is at par with the European countries and first rank in exports. In fact, this is again important. What we are promoting in this, we are here for 2 weeks in the United States, going to from here to Houston, Chicago, Washington, New York. And it's not anything to do with just investments or manufacturing. It has a lot. For example, Houston, our concentration is education. Here in San Francisco, our concentration is on startups, innovation, technology, and so on. So we are here also to see where our Gujarat companies, manufacturing and other companies, can take, can buy technology or enter into joint ventures and benefit from the technology that the US companies have developed. The main thing that distinguishes Gujarat is a policy-driven state. And we have a policy for virtually everything, every area of the economy. We do not have any one-to-one meetings or any negotiations across the table for any investment or for any other business. So we have a garment and apparel policy, agribusiness policy, aerospace and defense, electronics, general incentive scheme for industries, health, IT, wind power, biotechnology, industrial policy, solar, startup, tourism, manufacturing. And what is important again, tourism, IT and logistics have been given industry status. So they get all the benefits that a new industrial investment would get in the state. Various aspects of ease and doing business, I will not go much in detail into it, but generally it has been expressed and felt that Gujarat is a very, very leading state in the country in the ease to do business. In fact, in 2015, we got the first rank in the country in ease of doing business. Last year, we got second rank, and this year we are third rank. So these are some of the projects. Just I wanted to highlight before you, what direction is Gujarat taking in the next few years, or which are the projects, large projects that we are concentrating on in terms of scope for investment, scope for business, scope for trade and commerce. And these are all on the, it's not that they are being planned, it's all on the board. So we have the dedicated Delhi Mumbai Industrial Corridor, DMIC, and the dedicated freight corridor. 36% of it passes through Gujarat. The Dholera SIR is over special investment region, over 900 square kilometers. Infrastructure work has started about 2 years ago. Almost 3,000 crore has been spent on the infrastructure in Dholera SIR. And it will have, environment clearance has been given for a 5,000 megawatt solar park in Dholera. The Mandal Becharaji SIR, I wanted to just mention about Mandal Becharaji is about 100 kilometers from Ahmedabad. Just 20 kilometers from Ahmedabad is Sanand. The Sanand to Mandal Becharaji area is in the shape of a, not a circle, but an ellipse, so slightly elongated circle. It is developing to be the biggest automobile manufacturing hub in the world, like what Detroit was known once upon a time, with Japanese companies, Chinese companies, and Korean companies. And of course, the Ford Motors of USA has set up a big plant there. So Mandal Becharaji, it has a Japanese township also. And the Statue of Unity, which the Prime Minister is going to inaugurate on 31st of October in the Sardar Sarovar, near the Sardar Sarovar project on the Narmada Dam, it's complete, it will be inaugurated, unveiled on 31st October. It's the world's tallest statue, built at a cost of over 3,000 crore rupees. $450 million. This, why I have said is, it will throw up a lot of business opportunities, lot of investment opportunities, lot of education and recreation opportunities. Sorry. The Gift City. So we not in San Francisco, but in Chicago, the CEO of Gift and a four-membered team from GIFT will join us in Chicago, Washington, New York, because they are the financial centers. GIFT stands for Gujarat International Finance Tech City. It is spread over 650 odd hectares, so 1500 acres, and it is India's only international financial service center. So all the transactions in foreign currency can be done there. Bank of America is going to inaugurate its branch in Gift City very soon. They were going to inaugurate it last month. The date was also finalized, but then this cyclone or hurricane, I think, struck North Carolina. I think North or South Carolina. North Carolina, and that, and their headquarters is there. So then they had to postpone the inauguration, but their infrastructure is ready. The Ahmedabad-Mumbai high-speed rail, you may have heard of, the bullet train as it is called, with Japanese collaboration. In Gujarat, the land acquisition is almost complete for this project. The Dream City is the diamond research and mercantile city. It's being built on 2,000 acres of land in Surat. Again, the construction has started. It will be a diamond boards and for all kinds of facilities for diamond polishing, cutting, trading, and global trade, and jewelry manufacturing.
Hi, this is Jagruti for Sitare TV. India has changed the perception world over, and lot of contribution is gone to Modi ji, but at the same time, lot of work has been done by his very efficient staff. I've been in Silicon Valley for 20 years, but I've never seen such esteemed people being promoting India in such a way, concrete, very organized, a very legitimate and detailed way of presentation. The delegation is called as Vibrant Gujarat, and they are here to ask for investment in Gujarat. Arvindji, welcome to Bay Area, and we are Sitare TV. Tell us, what is one thing you want to take away or tell people that why you're here today and what will make you happy once you leave this place or go to India as a follow-up?
Thank you, Jagruti. We are a delegation from Gujarat but promoting both India and Gujarat. And the Vibrant Gujarat event has evolved over the years magnificently. It is the most important business event in the country today and very well known throughout the world. The specific takeaway I would like is for people to understand Gujarat as a prominent business state and to understand that investment is important, but what Gujarat considers important is to enable a business platform. And we are a major importer. We are looking at technology. Our companies are looking at technology. And for the purpose, we have an innovation ecosystem roundtable in Stanford University tomorrow morning, when we are going to discuss what Gujarat can give to Stanford University and what Stanford University can contribute to Gujarat and to India. So the one takeaway I would specifically like to take away from here is technology and innovation and how to improve development, the basic development of Gujarat people through modern technology and through modern innovations.
So you have a lot of projects coming for Gujarat and digitalization, and a lot of stuff requires billions of dollars. Forget about millions of dollars. How are you planning to get that money? Because I follow India very regularly, and I can see a lot of protests going on, a lot of political war, it's stable or not. And India being a country, a lot of bureaucracy comes across. How are you going to execute or deliver that project, especially in terms of finance and in terms of how many years it will take?
See, the opposition to the projects, they are twofold. I would not like to touch upon the political opposition. It is not for me to say anything about it at all. There has been some opposition in case of some projects from the land acquisition point of view. Farmers have come up saying that they are not willing to part with the land, or in most cases, they want a higher price for the land. In case of both DMIC, dedicated, the Delhi-Mumbai Industrial Corridor, and the dedicated freight corridor, I would like to tell you very pleasantly, the land acquisition is 99% complete.
Wow.
99% complete, and it is mostly with consent, because the government, the land acquisition is with the state government. The government has come up with a policy of giving a very, very remunerative price to the farmers for the land. In case of these two projects, the land is being acquired by the railways. They have also followed the policy adopted by the state governments. So the land acquisition is, and because the farmers benefit the most by the railway or the road or the canal coming alongside their farms, even in between the farms. So if they are given a good compensation, there is no opposition, they become a partner in that project. And that is what is happening in Gujarat today, particularly where the government has adopted a very liberal and robust policy to get land through consent from the farmers. Now regarding the funding, to give you one example, the bullet train, as it is called, the high-speed rail corridor between Ahmedabad and Mumbai, is funded. Its cost is about 1,05,000 crore, which is roughly, I would say, 14-15 billion US dollars. The Japanese government has given a loan at 0.1% interest. And it is 10-year moratorium and repayable over 30 to 40 years. So the financing will come out from the project itself. The state government or the central government is not spending a rupee on the bullet train project.
Wow, you see?
So this is how, on a public-private partnership mode, these projects are being taken up. Same again for the highways that are being built and for other major projects, where it is the policy of both the governments that to the extent that it is commercial or economic in nature, it should come from the project, If it is downstream for the people at large, it will be funded through the budget.
Last question for you. Vibrant Gujarat 2019. We always see it's a special project has been for Mr. Modi from the time he was a chief minister. And a lot of Indians follow us. Now the number of people traveling for Vibrant Gujarat has gone up quite a bit. Rather, they are sometimes more than even Pravasi Bharatiya Divas. Tell me something to our listeners who are watching you right now. Why should they attend Vibrant Gujarat and what should they expect out of it as a positive to them?
Vibrant Gujarat is mainly a business event. So definitely people who are interested in doing business with Gujarat, with any other state in Gujarat, can come to Vibrant Gujarat. It is not just a business event, I would go a step beyond. It is an experience. We are having not only business related programs, we are having discussions on technology, we are having TED style talks, we are having a youth forum, we are having special programs on renewable energy, we are having special programs on finance, on the gift city and finance. So it has become an event where anyone from any part of India wishing to do business with anyone from any part of the world can come to Gujarat, Vibrant Gujarat, use it as a platform to discuss and do business, whether it is import, whether it is export, whether it is technology transfer, whether it is investment, or exploring new partnership avenues. That is the beauty of Vibrant Gujarat. I would welcome you, Jagruti, and your TV team and all your viewers to come and participate in this experience of Vibrant Gujarat. Global Summit, 18, 19, 20th January 2019 at Gandhinagar, Gujarat.
So this is Arvind Agarwal from Vibrant Gujarat, representing Vibrant Gujarat as a committee. And what a detailed preparation they have. I must congratulate all of you that you were so well informed of everything you presented. And I hope it continues. And people watching me and listening to me will definitely reach out to or at least attend Vibrant Gujarat. It's my dream to attend once, maybe this year. So we'll go together. Thank you, Mr. Arvind, for joining
Thank
us.
Thank you. Thank you, Jagruti. Thank you very much.
Being a Gujarati, it's so nice to see a prime minister coming from a state where I belong to. And then when such cool things are happening around the world, very learned, very educated people joining Mr. Modi's campaign of Shining India. And one of the reasons this delegation is here, Vibrant Gujarat group, and I have a pleasure to meet Mr. Sunil. Actually, he is a pharmaceutical king. I'm sure his knowledge on pharmaceutical is fantastic, but that's the reason I'm not going to ask a question on pharma industry. We had a discussion today, and this has been going on. The moment it comes to Modi ji or Indian government, we think about IT, but there are so many sectors, like for example, healthcare industry, tourism, pharma, solar energy, alternative energies, IoTs, a lot of stuff are happening. What should, if you were me in US and you had to invest, what would be your choice if you had, suppose you were there for invest about $15 million or $20 million, what would you suggest or what would you take up as an investment which you feel is most safest one and most rewarding one?
India is a $2.5 trillion economy and it is growing at the rate of about 7-8% every year. Consequently, everything that is happening in the country is happening on a scale that has actually got a growth factor of close to 10% to 14% of growth year on year. And therefore, there is a demand for everything. A lot of our demand is actually being met through imports and from imports of goods and services. So if you look at our import bill or if you look at the services that are coming from abroad, and then you already know that there is a market for these products in India, you know the price at which are the products, and you also know the customers for these products. Now the question is, for being an US investor, what is it that you can bring on the table to make the same service available at a more cost-effective price and of a better quality? If you can answer these two questions satisfactorily, starting from as low as $5 million, going up to $1,000 million, which is a $1 billion project, all projects are viable in India. For example, from the US, we have companies that are doing clinical research where they start with $5 million investment. There are people who are in marketing and distribution with $10 million.
Right.
There are companies that are going into legal services and other kinds of accounting services and all kinds of new types of technology-based products that they are offering to customers and to corporates for as low as $20 million capital project of the cost. On the other side, you have a Ford which has invested $1 billion, and you have large investments coming in. So really, at the end of the day, the entire market is totally open and it is growing at a very fast speed. So I have no doubt that if investors from here bring something that is innovative, that can reduce cost or improve quality or do both, then the market for investment is profitable and one will easily look at a return on investment of between 15 to 20% per year.
Wow, that's a huge, which doesn't happen otherwise. Another question for you, Vibrant Gujarat, I have seen Modi ji or the government announcing a lot of MOUs. Percentage of MOUs materialize. I'm asking question from your side. Why do you see a reason when people do commit to MOUs, you do secure a business and they fall off? What is your plan or corrective measure so that they don't fall up over a period of time?
There are three major reasons why MOUs don't work. By the way, the overall implementation percentage of MOUs in Gujarat is the highest amongst all the states of India.
Wow.
And it is close to about 48% implementation. Now, the reason for the 52% not happening are three. One is that the market conditions change and the entrepreneur himself or the investor himself has now changed their mind about not doing the project at all. The second reason it happens is that there are certain requirements of the project that are not suited for in a state like Gujarat. And the third reason why sometimes these MOUs do not materialize is that they do not find a suitable local partner in the short possible time that they are looking for. Now, there are some things that the government can assist with, and that is approvals and incentives. But when it comes to getting land, doing the projects and getting loan from the banks, the government has no role in that. That is primarily in the market for finance, for getting all the technical partners and the legal partners to get your project off the ground. And therefore, there are a number of reasons. So one of the things that an agency which is responsible for ensuring that these projects do not fall off is been created, and it is called Indexed B. Their job is to ensure to find out, is the reason primarily because of entrepreneur himself changing their mind? Then of course there is nothing that we need to do. On the other hand, if it is something that he thought was there and was not there, then they try and make an attempt to solve the problem or to bring to the table something that the entrepreneur requires to make his help him fulfill his dreams. And therefore, this is now started working, and that is why Gujarat is higher in implementing projects than all the rest of all the other states in the country.
About Gujarat, Gujarati culture, I myself Gujarati, we have Gujarati diverse culture, food, we are very well known for a lot of festivities. Gujarat is a state, how much do you rate in terms of international tourism, and how do we NRIs can contribute to developing tourism in Gujarat, because it directly affects our employment, it directly affects the economy and directly affects the government. So what do you think?
Gujarat tourism has grown leaps and bounds. It has now reached 7 times its size of the number of tourists who come to Gujarat in the last 5 years. And earlier, Gujarat tourism was primarily only religious tourism, which means people go to Somnath and Palitana and Dwarka. These were the three places. So these are the three places that invariably used to come. Today, you know, we saw the sites. People come for Kutch, run of Kutch for Ran Utsav.
I want to come this year.
So November to February, you must come, and it is an excellent experience. It is Asia's largest white desert. For as long as your eye can see, you will see only a white desert, and there is a beautiful experience. People from foreign countries are coming there to shoot their films as if it is on ice, but actually they don't have to wear any woolen clothes. So it really makes the entire thing extremely cheap and extremely competitive and nice. And therefore, you know, there are at least 40, 45 sites today in Gujarat that are really being driven for tourism. And it's a thrilling experience to go there. Absolutely safe, extremely affordable, especially now with 75 rupees to the dollar. Yeah. If you spend something like $500, you get a king's treatment for a whole week in India. And which is like an awesome experience with hospitality, food, gourmet, shopping, and local travel.
And I like all those huts because I have been following Kutch Gujarat Ranotsav. I'm planning to come this year, maybe. How do you want to exploit or the respect of Modi or relationship with Mr. Trump to directly affect Gujarat? The reason I'm saying is I'm myself in tech industry and we are having challenges with this H1 staff. A lot of people cannot come. How do you want to exploit relationship or the present challenges of US to favor Gujarat? Do you have any idea?
I think what the ambassador said was that this is a historic high for the relationship between India and the US. And I think the way to go forward in this partnership is to continue to emphasize projects that are mutually beneficial. And so therefore, suppose there is an IT company and there is an issue of hiring people from India here. It doesn't mean that the IT company loses out and has to go back to India. All that they have to do is to fall in line and start recruiting local people of a level that they can afford. If they find that their costs are rising way high and making them non-competitive, then they can do here in the US what they have done in India. Take graduates and train them themselves. And therefore, with this, the entire tech industry problem will get totally stopped and solved in less than 3 years. And you will create a loyalty amongst the young Americans who have been trained by the very companies where they are employed subsequently.
So nicely said.
Yeah, so I think there are many solutions to these issues. The good part is that there is a very healthy relationship which exists to thrash out issues and discuss them on the table. The problem is if you don't have that friendship, then nothing will happen. And I really believe that, you know, Trump is saying make in America, India is saying make in India. The challenge is how do we make some things in America and some things in India so that the final product is enjoyed in the world market.
Very nicely said. Perfect. This is Mr. Sunil Parekh with me. He heads Zydus Cadila, a huge pharmaceutical venture back in India, has given fantastic products. And I'm sure the current economy, current situation of US relations with India and with the elections coming next year, it will be a very interesting reason to visit Vibrant Gujarat 2019 next year. And they can go online. Just briefly, you want to say what is the website where they can go and register?
Yeah, just go to Vibrant Gujarat 2019, Google it and you'll get the website. You can do online registration. And, you know, there is an app that has been developed where you can get appointments. You can look at all the people, delegates who are coming. You can look at all the speaker lists. And then you can seek appointment by just pressing on the name and sending them an email. And the system will then block a room for you for 20 minutes and get you an appointment with anybody you would like to meet amongst the 3,000-4,000 people that are going to be there, of the who is who. And therefore, you can meet anybody that you want in your field of interest, discuss businesses, discuss growth, discuss technology, discuss investments, whatever you want, and use the full opportunity over 3 days to connect up with as many people as you want and use it maximum to grow your own personal business.
Wow. So this is Vibrant Gujarat representation in Bay Area, and I'm so proud. Sir, thank you so much for visiting us and giving us another aspect of investment, and I wish you all the best.
To be here with you. Thank you so much for having me here.
So, Siddhara TV listeners, see you January. All these people in India, Vibrant Gujarat 2019.
Iski technology vaakai raah dikhane layak hai. With its standard pedestrian detection system and pre-collision system. Lekin iski cutting-edge styling hai vaakai dekhne layak. Ek baar experience karke dekhiye. The Lexus NX and the NX Hybrid, class-leading 31 mpg combined estimate ke saath. Lease kijiye 2019 Lexus NX 300 for $339 a month for 36 months. Experience amazing at your Lexus dealer.
India Currents, a monthly magazine, has a cover story, a travel column, film reviews, and more. There's something for everyone in this one-of-a-kind magazine. Pick up your copy or subscribe at indiacurrents.com.
If you want to see what's the latest going on at Sitare TV, who we're interviewing, what community events we're going to, join our community on Facebook.
As a head of USISPF, Dipti Desai, Tell me something, why this event? What do you think it's going to affect directly to the community?
So, you know, as part of USISPF, United States India Strategic Partnership Forum, we are very involved with businesses to business communication and interactions, and also business to business to government interactions. And government of India and also of Gujarat is very interested in working with the technology companies over here to see what is out here, what are the latest technologies, what can be adapted for India's use. As a result, they are here for almost 2 weeks. They're going to 5 different cities, starting with San Francisco, Houston, Chicago, DC, and then New York. And they're meeting with lots of different enterprises. They're meeting with a lot of different institutions and with, of course, the CGs in these different areas. And they're figuring out how can they leverage the latest technologies that are happening in the US and how can they adapt it and use it in India.
Wow.
India is such a large population. It is a huge market. There's a lot that can be done for it. And with our help, we can achieve a lot more. So,
wow.
Thank you.
And by the way, one thing I have to say, it's very nice to see the woman entrepreneurs getting involved. She has a fantastic career education background. And Dipti, it's so proud as a woman to see a woman organizing this so perfectly. Very nice arrangement with the food and everything. Congratulations for a fantastic event. And I hope you bring more and more events like that, which directly affects us as well as our mother country, India.
Thank you. Thank you. And it's good to see women over here too. So thank you for coming.
So this is Dipti, a rocking woman on Sitare TV. And so impressed with the arrangements and so impressed with the reason why people gathered here. Big hello to the Gujarati listeners. Kem cho? Aajkal Gujarat, aajkal nahi, jyarthi Modi sahib aavya chhe 2002 thi. ગુજરાતી હોવાનો આપણને કંઈ વધારે પડતો જ ગર્વ છે એન્ડ આઈ હોપ ઇટ કન્ટિન્યુઅસ અને એમાં એડ કરવા માટે નરેન્દ્ર મોદીની ટીમ આવી છે અહીંયા વાઇબ્રન્ટ ગુજરાતની બેરિયામાં એન્ડ આઈ હેવ મિસ્ટર પરાગ આઈ મીન એકચ્યુઅલી પરાગ આઈ હેવ ટુ ટેલ યુ આઈ એન્જોયડ લિસનિંગ ટુ યુ હાઉ વોઝ યોર એક્સપિરિયન્સ એડ્રેસિંગ ટુ ધ બેરિયા લિસનર્સ હિયર
વેલ થેન્ક યુ સો મચ ફોર this opportunity here. The Bay Area entrepreneurs I've been engaged with for a very long time. A lot of my friends are venture capitalists on Sand Hill Road. These are people that I went to school with in Baroda. They went to MS University. They're well settled here and they're doing extremely well. So the Valley crowd is a proponent of India, but they see a lot of hurdles because India absolutely does not move at the pace at which US moves. એટલે પણ છતાંય મારે બધાને એક વસ્તુ કહેવી છે કે હું છેલ્લા 20 વર્ષથી ઇન્ડિયન ગવર્મેન્ટ અને ગુજરાત ગવર્મેન્ટ સાથે કામ કરું છું. કોઈ બી ગવર્મેન્ટ જોડે કામ કરવામાં તકલીફ તો પડે જ છે. એ આપણો રિઝોલ્વ કેટલો છે, આપણો ડિટર્મિનેશન અને કમિટમેન્ટ કોઈ પ્રોજેક્ટ પાછળ કેટલું છે, દેટ ડિસાઇડ્સ કે વેધર યુ ગોન સક્સીડ ઓર ફેલ. કેમ કે એટ ધ એન્ડ ઓફ ધ ડે ગવર્મેન્ટવાળા બી આપણાથી કંટાળે છે. એટલે આપણે આદુ ખાઈને એમની પાછળ પડી જઈએ તો દે આર વિલિંગ ટુ લિસન ટુ અસ, દે આર વિલિંગ ટુ ગીવ ઇન ટુ વોટ વી આર આસ્કિંગ ફોર, એઝ લોંગ એઝ ઇટ ઇઝ ઓલ ફોર ધ બ્રોડર ગુડ. It takes a little bit of time to convince them that it is for their own constituents and it's for the broader good. But I will tell you, I have had adversities, but I have never been stopped in my path in achieving what I had gone out to do for the betterment of Gujarat.
We know our country more than anybody. We know the shortcomings, but at the same time, we know the positivity. So like it's like playing in a home ground where you know when it's going to rain and when it's not going to rain and when the grass is green. So that gives you a better idea where you are investing. And it's our own country, which we want to be proud of. We have, as we Indians have been shying away, telling people our country is this. But from the time Mr. Modi has come and the way people are applauding him one over the world, we have got a lot of confidence. But my question to you is still people think how to reach the right people, how to make sure that my investments are safe in US, right? How do you want to suggest to them that what is the best approach or white paper practice in case after listening to this they feel they're reaching out to you, I want to know what it is or I want to invest?
So India's story, in my opinion, lies in the bottom strata of society. If any entrepreneur sees that as an opportunity and wants to build a product or a service to attend to the bottom strata of the society, they will absolutely succeed. I'm going to give you one example. I like talking by facts. Rather than referring to other people's numbers, I will tell you my own examples, my own interactions, and that those are reinforcing because those are factual. One of my board members runs a very large, he's a US dollar billionaire, and he runs India's one of the largest fast goods FMCG company, fast moving consumer goods company. he had a product that was being sold for 60 rupees and it was bottled. Although we know that the product is addressed for the lower strata of society, 60 rupees is a stiff price for a day wage employee, worker, to spend out. His son came into the business and converted the product into a 1 rupee sachet.
Wow.
And the sales went up 400 times.
Wow.
So the example I'm trying to give you is, your product was geared towards the lower strata, but the upper band of the lower strata. The minute you have the vision of saying that I want to cater to the lowest of the lower strata, your sales become fourfold.
Very true. But so, the percentage of consumers goes
but up there. Every American is taught to chase the dollar. My advice to any entrepreneur in Silicon Valley is, in the India story, chase the penny.
Very interesting question I want to ask you is, I have followed Mr. Modi's visit to US. He has met a lot of entrepreneurs, Facebook, Google, and especially the Indian origin CEOs too, Sundar Pichai and all. So I was wondering how much they have influenced the other investors to come, and how much was the success in having them invest in India, not necessarily Gujarat, and how we are going to exploit them or use them or influence them to have people invest in Gujarat too.
You're talking about the large tech companies?
Yeah, for everybody, not just tech companies. He had the opportunity to meet the most of the CEOs of the renowned companies.
Yeah, so again, I go back to saying, look, Microsoft has been in India before Narendra Modi got elected as the Prime Minister. So has IBM. But the Modi government has made policies extremely, extremely conducive for businesses that are not Indian. And they're trying, like I've said before. Rome was not built in a day, and neither will India get built in a day. What people should be proud about, and it's not just the Modi government. India as general has had forward progress if you look back last 20 years. I have been going to India for the past 20 years every 5 to 6 weeks. So if there is somebody that gets that side of India, who gets to analyze it so frequently, I'm telling you, every visit is progressive compared to the one previous. So India is on a forward progress. This government has specifically addressed pain points and try to eradicate them. Now, in my opinion, a lot of these pain points were for the larger enterprises and the larger companies. If a smaller entrepreneur wants to go in and fix a smaller problem, their hurdles are not even comparable by what the Googles or the Microsofts, the Fords of the world face, because their business transactions are not that complex. So, yes, can you learn from them? Yes, are they laying the path for you? Absolutely. But if you have the drive, so there is a Silicon Valley entrepreneur called Paul Needham, and you can look him up, and he has created a solar solution for the Indian marketplace. And just look up Paul Needham and Google him and see what he has been able to do for India, the poor in India, and bringing energy to Indians in villages where there is no electricity. And he has raised the millions of dollars in venture funding. So if he can do it, you should be able to do it. There's no reason for us to look for excuses. Like I said, either you watch or you participate. The choice is yours.
And last question. Vibrant Gujarat next year, okay? And this whole event also was to invite people to Vibrant Gujarat. Give us one tip or one suggestion where we, if people are attending, it becomes more fruitful to them. What do you suggest to people who are listening who want to attend the Vibrant Gujarat?
So it's no different than asking a question, why should I go to Davos? Right? Very little actually happens in Davos. But there's a lot of learning. Because it doesn't always have to be that you go there and conduct a transaction. You go to Davos because you want to get a broader spin of what is happening geopolitically, business-wise, future, technology. You get a lot of opinions from leaders and that don't truly have political vendetta. They just speak their mind. Believe it or not, although it might seem like Vibrant Gujarat is a political event, and it is, because it is paid by the government, the rhetoric is not. There are people from all walks of life there that are engaging with everybody else. It's a tremendous platform for networking. It's a tremendous platform for learning what is happening in India, good and bad, and actually seeing it firsthand and listening to stories firsthand. you're engaging with people that are walking the walk and talking the talk. And you really don't get that chance for a couple of $1,000. So that's your opportunity there. And then this year they've tried to club it with Pravasi Bharatiya Divas and Kumbh Mela. So if you're truly an Indian that enjoys all those facets of the Indian offering, then you have multiple reasons to go to India during that time. And you might even go to Ahmedabad a couple of days early and do some Uttaran there and kite flying. So all in all, it can be a very positive experience if you do choose to make it to India at that time.
Perfect. So this is Jagruti covering for Sitare TV, a beautiful event, Vibrant Gujarat. Even if you are not gone before, like me, and if you are going first time, there is a lot of thing to learn and see how the things work, how the business entrepreneurs meet, and you can always network. If not, have fantastic food in Gujarat, in Ahmedabad, do some kite flying, and of course, go to Ranotsav, which I'm going to go. I'm inviting all the Gujaratis and every listener of Sitare TV to visit Gujarat once in a lifetime. Moreover, Amitabh Bachchan also is the ambassador. Thank you so much for joining Sitare TV. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Jagruti.
Today is 23rd September and Sitare TV has covered a very, very interesting event, representation of Gujarat in the name of Vibrant Gujarat. The delegates here, they presented why to invest, where to invest and what to do. This is Sitare TV, 23rd September in Milpitas, covering Vibrant Gujarat Committee in Bay Area. Be sure to watch Sitare every week. Sitare. To catch your favorite star profiles. Sitare. Celebrity interviews. Sitare. Community events. And more.
Sitare TV.
Sitare TV.
Sitare
right
TV.
Here.
Sitare TV.
Sitare TV.
Sitare TV.
Sitare TV.